Good evening. You listen to Boston Politics here, and we've got two special guest hosts tonight, and that is Reverend Eugene Rivers and Leonard Lee. We're going to go right to them. Give us a call, 617-282-0685.
Good evening, everybody. We're coming to you from Boston Praise Radio here in Boston at headquarters in the house of Reverend Dr. Pastor Bruce H. Wall, y'all. He's the man, right, to be bringing it, right? He's the hostess with the mostest, as we used to say back in the day, right? And so we're here, and we're going to get it in this evening. We are living in a very sort of historic period politically in terms of our community, in terms of the role and function of the church, and in particular, the black church and churches of color, if you will. And so for the next hour or so, we go get it in and start talking about the what's going on politically in our city and how it is, how important it is. And we can't stress it enough tonight that everybody got to go out and vote next Tuesday. That's don't
right.
sleep.
That's right.
And I'm here with my main man, the genius. Another mostest with the mostest, Leonard Lee. What's your middle initial, man?
It's M.
Leonard M. Lee. Now, I'm Eugene Franklin Rivers III. Eugene F. Rivers III, right? There was three of us. It was triplicate, right? So I'm here with Leonard M. Lee.
The first.
All right, the first.
There is a second.
Who's going to hold it down and bring it to us and sort of share some thoughts with the community about how we need to, no matter who you vote for, you need to vote. Everybody need to vote. Everybody need to get up.
Definitely.
Next Tuesday, I'm not going to say like some other folks say often and early. I just want you to vote once. I don't want you to break no laws. As has been a custom and tradition in this town, that folk would vote often and early, and their cousins who were dead, and Sean and Mikey, and no. So we would just want you to obey the law, do the right thing, and next Tuesday, all day, right? I think the polls open at 8 o'clock and close at 8 o'clock. Is that right?
That's right. That's right.
And so we want you to get it in, right? Get up and stand up.
That's right.
And go to the polls, like Public Enemy, get up and stand up. And go to the polls. You know, y'all got to play that one. That's a good neutral one. So we want you to do that. Now, I want to talk about a number of things this evening, but I want to sort of turn it over to sort of let it lead to talk to us about some of the things we should be thinking about. And we want to talk about some of these endorsements. A number of major leaders in our community have come out in support of Charlotte Gola Ritchie, and there have been others that are supporting other people. But it's really very, very interesting, and it sort of highlights the significance of the church.
That's right.
And because quiet as it's kept, y'all, if you actually, literally, I thought about this one day. I put my mind on this thing. And I said, if you monetize all the property and assets under control that churches have, their property, extended property, the land, and we were to, you know, monetize and total up all the real estate that the black churches, we are the richest and the most powerful people up in this piece.
Oh, no, definitely.
You know what I'm saying?
Definitely.
I mean, a lot of Negroes who don't go to church, who are sleeping, don't understand that the black church, at its worst, at our most ignorant, we are the most powerful. We are, by default, the most influential. We are clearly the richest, from the storefront to the mega church. Amen, right? You know, and so it's very interesting because most black people don't think logically about the fact that the biggest real estate holder you got in the black community is black church.
The black church, that's right.
Okay, now we got to do more with the black church, and the black church needs to do more. But we are the major economic engine. If we did offerings, real estate, you know, chicken fry, dinners, entrepreneurship,
yeah.
Dinners,
yeah.
We the ones. So Leonard M. Lee. What's your middle name, man? What's that? M for what?
Marion.
Leonard Marion Lee, the first. Yeah. Let's talk about this campaign and what you think and what's on your mind.
Well, the first and foremost is you have to get out and vote. I mean, people have died. Our elders are rolling over in their graves of the time that they stood in line for hours, and we don't celebrate it by coming out and voting. And as Rev just said, the importance is I don't care who you vote for, but you must vote.
Right.
Because what's going to happen is that we complain when we don't get what we need.
Right.
Our services in our community, but we don't go out and show people by representing ourselves in the voting booth. I mean, it's just it kind of blows me away. But we have to get out there and vote, and we got to vote in numbers. So tell your friends, tell your sisters, tell your brothers,
that's right,
tell your aunts,
right,
your uncles, your mothers,
yeah.
And remember, you know, I think it's very interesting. I think we talked about this last week that a lot of females, women, hold up the church, and we
right.
got to understand as we make. The church makes us accountable through the word.
Right.
We have to make them accountable, and we work together to build.
That's right.
And that's why I'm pretty excited about this election. I'll tell you why. Because looking at the list of endorsements around a particular candidate, it really warms my heart to see that there have been a number of people who have come together to understand the bigger picture. It's not about them as individuals. It's about our community.
Absolutely. No, you're absolutely right. I mean, it is so significant, it's so historic that we've got a talented, brilliant, sharp, attractive, professional mother, wife, resident of the hood who is running to be the next mayor of this city.
That's right.
And we thank God for her, for her vision, her commitment, her energy. It's a good thing, right? And you know, we've got a number of people that have endorsed her. And Dr. Lee, could you share with the our listening audience the caliber of the kinds of important people we got up in this piece that are stepping up and stepping out to endorse Charlotte Golda Ritchie?
Well. One that really warms my heart because of the history and significance of this man came from Tuskegee, Alabama. If those who are not familiar...
Tuskegee, y'all. Do you hear what my man said? Tuskegee.
From Selma to Tuskegee to Birmingham to Montgomery, where if it wasn't for those, we would not have what we have today. But the mayor of Tuskegee found
wow.
it so important that he endorses this woman. He came up here to endorse her. That's Mayor Johnny Ford. He's the mayor of Tuskegee,
stop,
Alabama.
Stop.
One
really?
Of the longest standing
wow.
mayors in the history of Tuskegee.
That's true.
So when you're talking
that's
about
real talk.
Fight, when you're talking about somebody who saw all the different things that we that was happening during the Civil Rights era,
right.
He was up front.
That's
so,
right.
So he recognized the importance of him coming
right.
all the way up from Tuskegee, Alabama to support Charlotte Golda Ritchie.
Absolutely. Wow. That's right. One of the mayor of Tuskegee, Alabama, y'all. That's a big deal, y'all.
That's huge.
That's huge. I mean, in fact, I'm told that there are a number of mayors from around the country.
That's right.
That may be coming to the city of Boston
right.
to endorse Charlotte Golda Ritchie, and that's a good thing and a big thing. And so we want Crystal and Peaches and Shaniqua and Bumquisha and Leroy and Clarence and Tariq and Willie, everybody. We want y'all to get up, stand up, and come out and vote on next Tuesday. We want all the preachers, right? We want you on Sunday to remind everybody in your church on Sunday that they got a job to do on Tuesday,
right,
which is to go out and vote. We want everybody voting, right? And voting early, voting in the afternoon, voting in the evening. You understand? Let's just get this thing going here, right? And then, again, preachers, we want all the pastors and evangelists and apostles and bishops to encourage their people. Look, y'all, we got a job to do. And on Tuesday, we getting up and out, and we're going to get the vote popping. That's what we need to be doing about that, right? So who else we got? Who are some of the other?
Well, I'm going to bring it home.
Okay.
I'm going to take it back.
That's right.
Our former state representative, Doris Bunty, also, who, she was in charge of the Boston Housing Authority, I think.
That sounds about right. If memory serves, as they say. If memory serves.
And another trailblazer in our community who has, you know, she's an elder that's been here. She knows the city. She knows the fight that we had to get to where we're at today. And she has recognized the importance of having a qualified. Remember, for us, when the country gets a cold, we have pneumonia. So therefore, when we go for positions, I'm not going to call anybody out, but those who don't look like us can have a GED, and we have to have our PhD to get the same job.
There you go.
So
That's actually statistically true.
No, that is true. But she, our former state rep, Doris Bunty, has seen so much. She has recognized the importance of having somebody who's not only qualified, but has the skill set to make and bring about really positive changes in this city.
That's right. So who else we got on there, Doctor?
We got former state rep Shirley Owens Hicks.
Wow, we got some show enough ballers and shot callers up in here.
That's right.
Oh, they're endorsing this woman.
We got my fraternity brother, Richard Taylor.
Whoa.
Former director of transportation.
Yes, that's right. Now, he's a brother, another big baller.
Yeah, big baller. A lot of stuff around transportation when he was here.
That's good, man. That's good.
We have former ambassador of Tanzania, Reverend Charles Stith, who had the church down in the South End.
That's right. Union United Methodist, my main man.
That's right.
Ambassador Charles R. Stith.
Who's currently over at BU.
Well, he runs a very distinguished program for former African heads of state at Boston University. No, it's some high cotton. Ambassador Stiff be on some high cotton. He be rolling with the big dogs.
That's right.
Over there at BU and going all around Africa and everywhere and doing everything.
And he's not, you know, it's interesting that all these people who have been endorsing Charlotte are those who have fought before. So they recognize and they know serious talent.
That's
they
right.
know someone who's committed. It's hard to put the wool over their eyes because they've seen so much before.
Been there, done that.
Yeah,
been there, done that.
That's right.
Been there, done that.
That's right.
That's right. Anybody sleeping?
We have Louis Gossip Jr.
Whoa.
Who,
Louis Gossip.
That's right. All the way from West Coast.
That's right. From Hollywood.
To endorse
Wow, that's
Charlotte.
A big deal. Yeah. Now, whoa.
We got Victoria Rorell. Who's used to be with City? I think with City Hall. She was City Hall for a while.
Okay.
Oh, my main man, Professor Charles Ogletree.
Charles J. Ogletree Jr. That's right.
From Harvard.
Harvard Law School, if you please. The director of the Charles Houston Hamilton Institute. That's right. My man, Professor A.K.A. Tree.
And it's interesting, again, those who've done so much work in the battleground before, now they can recognize someone as talented as Charlotte to come forth, and they have given their support to wrap around her as she goes towards being our next mayor. Organizations, Massachusetts Women Political Caucus.
Wow.
Emily's List, that's huge.
Yeah, that is very huge. That's big. Yeah, now we just need this. Our sisters from Brattle Street.
That's right.
They're from Brattle Street and up there in Harvard Square, right, to step up and step out. And let's now rally and make a final big push.
That's right.
Right, to support our sister, Charlotte Golda Ritchie. No, absolutely. So what else we got up in that thing?
Ward 4 and Ward 12. Ward 12 is really important to the black community. Very, very organized. And they've wrapped their arms around Charlotte. And a lot of the leadership in Ward 12, again, this is consistent message of folks who have been around, who have fought for the things that we have in place now, and can definitely see our talent and someone who has vision and someone they can believe in to bring about real change in the city.
I love it. I love it. You know, look, it's amazing. It's amazing all the notable people, all the fancy people. This is really very, very significant. I am really very impressed. We've got all the other preachers. We've got Bishop Gideon Thompson, Bishop A. Livingston Foxworth.
Oh, great.
Bishop
yeah.
Frank Kelly of Way of the Cross, and Pastor Gerald Bell and Matthew Thompson. Oh no, we got the roll call here.
Whoa.
These are all the ballers, the mega ballers and shot callers in the town, right? You know, Reverend Greg Fernandez and Reverend Jeffrey Brown of 12th Baptist Church and Reverend Elizabeth Walker
yes.
of Roxbury Presbyterian Church. No, we got some amazing people that have sort of lined up, and we're calling on everybody in the hood around the city to step up and come out and let's vote often. And like I said, Peaches and Crystal and Sharon and Karen and Lois and LaQuisha, we want all y'all to get up and stand up.
That's right.
And come out and vote on this Tuesday coming.
So, River, let me ask you a question. You know, as I said earlier, a lot of these folks are old school who've seen the wars in the past in terms of helping and support for the future. Can you tell me, why do you think all these folks are wrapping their arms around Charlotte? I mean, she's a beautiful woman.
Yeah, I got that. No, she's
a wonderful family.
Oh, the whole
great
thing.
Great husband.
Yeah, yeah. No, right, I mean, right.
Can you just elaborate on it? Because I know some people in our listening audience are saying to ourselves, oh, yeah, they're reading the list. Oh, yeah. Well, you know.
Well, see, I think it's about making history.
Mm.
I think it's about making a statement.
Mm.
So it's about making history. It's about making a statement. It's about letting people know that you're paying attention and not sleeping.
Mm.
We have a sister who was qualified, got all the credentials, you know, is articulate, very professional, who is eminently qualified to do the job. And, I think that people that have wisdom and insight recognize talent. And so our best and brightest have stepped up to encourage and support and nurture and back the sister who's running. I think it's a quality issue.
Mm.
People are stepping up because they see quality. You understand? It's mold and color. It's quality.
Mm.
Now, ain't nothing wrong with having some color with some quality. I want to say that so some of y'all feel funny about that, right? See, I ain't got a problem with color because I'm black. I'm not even black. I'm black, right? So I'm supporting there for the quality, and I appreciate the color.
Well, you know, I think it's interesting because, again, you know, I was talking to some friends of mine, and one particular, this guy on the bus said to me, well, she doesn't even live in the black community. And I had to correct him because I had to tell him that she lives in one of the highest crime areas that she's been working to help change for the past 10, 20 years.
Yeah.
And he challenged me. He said, oh, no, she lives up on the hill. She lives way up. I said, no. I said, listen, if you know this community, you know Percival. Percival Street's public knowledge, so I'm not sharing anything that people don't know. You will know that she's committed to living and raising her family in the community. She's not just talking it, she's walking.
That's right.
Because for her to walk to Charmet or to Fields Corner, she goes through the community saying hello to her neighbors and people that she's
right.
bonded with over
That's
the
right.
years.
That's right. That's absolutely right. Yo, I don't understand how dude. So that dude just didn't know.
No, he didn't know.
Oh,
he didn't look at it and say, oh, that's a middle class. That's a middle class sister. She can't relate to me.
No, that ain't true. Dude didn't do his homework. The sister lives over there in the hood, right? Right off Bowdoin Street.
Right off Bowdoin.
You know what I'm saying? Up there with the crew.
That's right.
Up there. No.
Organizing for years.
Yeah,
for years.
No, absolutely. Been in the trenches, you know, representing and holding it down and and you know, and working very successfully. There are a lot of other things that she could have done. She had gone into the private sector.
Oh no, she could have moved. She could have moved up on Fort Hill.
Fort Hill.
She could have moved up. She would have went to Beacon Hill, put her kids in some old big time school.
Right.
And this was a walk through, a bypass.
Child, she didn't deliver. She could have lived in Lexington.
Oh, that's right.
And kept it down.
That's right.
You know what I'm saying? No noise. No rah-rah.
That's right.
Ain't got to hear gunshots at night, and
whatever, right?
No. No, she's absolutely first class. And that's why all these people have stepped. These first class people have come out to support a first class candidate.
That's right.
That's real basic. 5% sure about the mathematics of it, right? That's the mathematics of it, right? No, she's the one. And we are so thankful to all of the quality people that have stepped up and come out to support her. Absolutely. Absolutely essential. Absolutely.
Well, you know, I had an opportunity to hear her at a couple of forums. And as you know, Pastor, my background is youth violence.
Right.
And so that's where a lot of my concern is, because I buried too many young people over the years. And so that's been a lot of my focus. But then I did my due diligence as knowing her,
right.
I checked out where she's just coming from. From Youth Build USA,
yeah.
Which works with young people, teaching them the trades,
right.
Getting them employed, taking them out of a situation and bringing them into a better situation.
Sure.
So she's been heading that up, not only on a local level, but also on a national level,
yep.
Of doing some work.
No. I mean, she has done a commendable job at DND, Youth Build, focusing her concerns on how to help people get resources and to be empowered. And for that, she should be commended. And for that track record of accomplishment and performance, we need to be standing strong with her on Tuesday. When we get out to vote.
So, Rev, I got to ask you a question. And I'm not trying to challenge anything, but you ain't just making this up on the brother. I mean, don't get me wrong. I do know a lot of this stuff is true. But can you just elaborate on some of your personal experiences that you had and why you feel the way you feel about Shop?
Oh, no. Listen, look. Anybody know me in this town? No, look, I say what I think. The Negroes think they can tell. I don't know why Negroes think they can tell a black preacher what he can say. You understand? Oh, no, yeah, to all y'all listening out here, right? And you political, sophisticated people who think you know what you're doing. Listen, God got to work to make sure the black preacher say what he's supposed to say. So, you know, if God got to work to make the preacher, you ain't going to tell him what to say. So just leave the Negro preacher alone. We are unique. W.E.B. Du Bois, it's very interesting. W.E.B. Du Bois said that the black preacher was the most unique personality in character that black America ever produced. Now, it's a very interesting thing, right? And so I say all that to say that the black preachers have stepped up, you know, and we did it because we nobody hustled us, nobody rolled us, nobody offered us a job. We said we're gonna stand with this woman who is quality and color and stand by this sister. And so Charlotte has always been, I've known her for years,
yeah,
she's always been straight ahead, decent, earnest, sincere, she loves her black husband and her black kids. And so I say, thank you, Jesus, for that. So, you know, good, intellectual, sophisticated, urbane, comes from good people, got a little Bayesian flavor up in that thing, right? And so she's, I know her, and listen, and we're going to go all the way with Charlotte. And that's my commitment, period. But they say, ride or die. We'll get it done.
God, that's excellent. That's excellent.
Yeah, no. So, just an extraordinary human being.
And well, she comes from good stock. I mean, yeah. I was talking to a Reverend Callender out of Harlem.
Right.
It's his 87th birthday. And he spoke highly of her father and his commitment to helping people who are underserved. And how he committed his life. And that was
love it.
And I see that being her example of how she disseminates that type of love to her community.
Love it. No, that's what I'm talking about. So we've got to do something new. You know, in endorsing and supporting Charlotte Golda Richie, we're going to let the world know, right, that, you know, quality, you know, women, you know, make history, you know, for black people. You know, like we did 30 years ago, Mel King.
That's right, yeah.
I was all up in that Mel King joint.
Yeah.
You know, we support Mel, man.
I remember my mom bought me a dashiki. She said, you're going to be a little Mel.
Yeah, little Mel King.
I remember that.
Mel King wasn't that nice, man. He's coming hard. Mel King was 100 with it.
That's right.
He come up in there and say, ain't nobody skinning and grinning, dude.
That's right.
It's a new day.
That's
right. He was something else, man. He's a tough brother, boy. And so now the black community has an opportunity to make history. Again.
Well, you know, it's interesting because, you know, we got a lot of other candidates of color in the race. And I'm not taking anything from anyone because I know a lot of people personally. But, you know, I always think of best and brightest. I always think, and not taking away, because I'm not going to claim that I'm best and brightest. I will share that. I will give that to you or to Mr. Hobbs. I'll give it to anyone who I feel deserves it.
Yeah, I understand.
So I don't float on my boat.
Yeah, I got you.
I keep it real and keep it focused because at the end of the day, it's about my great-grandchildren.
There you go.
And the man that may marry my daughter.
That's what I'm
talking about. He's not even her. He don't even have a boyfriend, but I'm talking about future in terms of those.
That's what you're supposed to be thinking.
Exactly.
Yeah, that's what I'm talking about. Yes, sir. No. I agree with you, brother. I mean, we've got to be thinking future. And the black community's got to be thinking future.
Mm.
You know, just got to be thinking future and being more creative. I mean, and it's interesting on that best and brightest thing, right? And leadership has to be associated with performance and not titles.
Yes, yes.
We got a lot of people that should be supporting Charlotte that ain't. We got, I ain't going to get too deep with that. We got some women that are elected officials who'll be supporting the sister that ain't.
Mm.
Right, you know, and you get these people that are scared to tell the truth and weaving Bob, right?
Mm.
Everybody should be closing ranks around the number one, right? Now, I'm saying it because I'm a preacher, and the preacher is free to say what he wants because God gave him the power of utterance.
Mm.
We can articulate because we got the breath that God gives us in our bodies to say what we believe the truth to be.
That's right.
Somebody say amen.
Amen. Amen.
Yeah, so we're going to say it. Everybody should be rallying around the sister. You know, and we should be using this as an opportunity to sort of educate the black community.
Yes.
You know?
Yes.
Because truth be told, like I say this, right? See, we should have been preparing for this 30 years ago.
I agree. Definitely. Definitely.
And all the people that say they're political types need to repent. Because in 83, after the election, there should have been a meeting to delegate Mel King's successor 30 years ago.
You're right.
You understand? So I'm not going to let folk off the hook about that, right? You sit up here talking about black political leadership, and you've been around here over 30 years, and you didn't put in play what should have been in play.
That's right.
Then that's on you, and you don't blame nobody else. But thank God we've got a good candidate that we are rallying around, and we're encouraging everybody else rally around. But the thing, I'll tell you something interesting. That, you know, about the politics of this. See, I think we have come to the end of a period where the traditional black electoral political system is close to defunct. Don't say that.
Mm.
See, we're electing a lot of people who keep seats warm. They don't get a lot done.
That's right.
And they tell us, vote for me because I'm a black woman, or vote for... No.
Forget about that.
No. Yeah. And so you get a pass, and then you don't produce. And so we've got to get to a point, and it's literally got to be, you know, Jesus says you can't put new wine into an old wineskin. You can't roll with the same obsolete categories and paradigms and frameworks. Well, we got to have a new framework because... The electoral political game locally for us is not generating the kinds of outcomes on the part of our black elected officials.
That's right.
I mean, you got $20 billion worth of development coming into Roxbury, Dorchester, Mattapan, and black people ain't getting a nickel of
it. Not a nickel.
And ain't nobody in the current regime stood up to say, you know what, we're going to get a piece of that.
That's right.
Which is crazy.
That's right.
Got black elected officials, $20 billion worth of money coming in. The DRM, Dorchester, Roxbury, Mattapan.
That's right.
Right, and we ain't got a dime. And you know, and
we don't have our waterfront.
No, ain't no waterfront. Ain't no development deals being put in place for black people. Now you know that ain't gonna happen in South Boston.
Oh, never.
You know, them boys gonna get a piece of that.
Big Dig made more millionaires. Oh, the waterfront made more millionaires.
Okay.
Than in the past 100 years of this town.
Okay. Now and we ain't got two nickels to rub together.
Ain't got two nickels.
And people that look in your face say, I'm a black leader because you were elected. Well, dude, if you're a leader, you produce.
That's right.
You've got a business plan. You got a model. You're going to talk about how we're going to get a piece of some of that economic development.
That's right.
And if you're not producing that, you're not a leader.
That's right.
You a dude with a title keeping a seat warm.
Actually, you're a blocker.
You're blocking. Yeah.
You need to get out the way.
Watch yourself now.
Come on. No. I'm just trying to keep
watch
it real.
Watch it, Lee. I'm just trying to keep it real. Well, then watch it now. I'm telling the truth now. I don't hurt nobody. I don't want you to hurt nobody, Lee. Because you know we got sensitive Negroes out here who I got delicate sensibilities.
They don't produce much,
but they got very delicate sensibilities.
Come on. We're burying too many young people. We have too many unemployed.
Right.
The whole nine. I just want to remind everybody once again, we're at Boston Praise Radio and TV Network, and we're sitting here having a discussion about a promise to change the city that has never been changed before. And only you can make that promise happen. We're going out and vote. It takes you about 15, 20 minutes.
Let's get it in, y'all.
We just happen to be blessed with a candidate that's not only qualified, but exquisite integrity and from our community. Charlotte Golick Ritchie.
All right.
There are people chosen to leave this world in the human race, and people born to follow and taught God's great grace. And then there are givers who understand the needs of the fellow man. When love rules their hearts and courage takes a stand, humanity linked together hand in hand. We are standing the human race. We are faith, holding on to a brighter day. We are hope, looking for a better way. We are charity, looking out for a fellow man. We take the courage to the fight. Take what's wrong and make it right. Walk through the darkness to the light, following the sun to regain our sight. We are loved, depending on God above. We are grace, understanding the human. Looking for a better way. We are charity, looking out for a fellow man. Life is bigger than you and me. Takes a village to raise a family. That means it's up to all humanity.
We are grace.
This is a community alert. You will not want to miss the upcoming Community United Political Action Committee's meeting entitled A Community Forum on the State of the Leadership of the Boston Police Department. That's going to be this coming Thursday, September 19th, 7 p.m. This coming Thursday, September 19th, 7 p.m. at the Global Ministries Christian Church, 670 Washington Street in Dorchester. That's 670 Washington Street in Dorchester. This is an open discussion on the past and current issues facing the community of color. This is an open meeting to the community. It's a forum and all are welcome. Manlio has been invited. Commissioner Ed Davis has been invited. And the police from the city of Lowell. Hosting this event will be Boston Black Empowerment Coalition, Blackstonian, Boston Praise Radio and TV, and the Communities United Political Action Committee. Again, that's Thursday, September 19th, 7 p.m. This Thursday, September 19th, 7 p.m. Thursday, September 19th, 7 p.m. at the Global Ministries Christian Church, 670 Washington Street in Dorchester. See you there. Hi, this is Pastor Bruce Wall. You will not want to miss the Down Home Delivery Restaurant's Customer Appreciation Day. It's going to be Sunday, October 6, 2013, starting at 2 p.m. and going all the way to 5. Join us and meet our restaurant staff and all the staff and members of Boston Praise Radio and TV. Down Home is going to give a free soda and dessert with every meal and 10% off your next Sunday dinner. We want to say hello and tell you how much we appreciate your business. So again, Sunday, October 6th. Sunday, October 6th, 2 p.m. to 5 p.m. at Down Home Delivery Restaurant at 2 Bowden Street in Dorchester. See you there.
Thing we have to do is put it in our mind.
Here we are.
Leonard M. Lee the first.
Reverend Eugene F. Rivers the third, y'all. I want y'all to get that right.
And we've been celebrating the promise of Tuesday. The promise that we've been told by someone we all know who just happened to be saved. That our next mayor is going to be Charlotte Goldie Ritchie.
And that's what we're working for. And see, the thing that is important for everybody to understand, you know, newspapers do not dictate your reality.
Oh, not at all.
So for those of y'all who are feeling down or because some particular newspaper might have written an editorial or forecasting some other outcome, y'all need to get yourself together. If black people have to rely on the media to determine their future, they'd still be on slave ships.
That's right.
So, people, y'all need to get your backbone together, get a little fortitude, in my case, testicular, right? And get yourself together and understand that we in it to win it. We go hard, and we're not so colonized in our minds.
That's right.
That just because a particular paper of record says that you can't win, that you think you're not going to win. Stop being such a chump.
That's right.
A coward and a weakling, right? We fight. Martin Luther King had to rely on the national press to support him when he was in Montgomery, Birmingham, Albany. If he had to rely on them, that boy wouldn't have got out to bed.
That's right.
Yeah, when they locked him up in Birmingham and he wrote the letter from the Birmingham jail, he was not relying on the editorial board of the New York Times to love him. And if he was waiting for love to come from them to inspire him, he was in trouble.
That's right.
You know, so folk need to stop being so weak. I know, I have to tell you, see, what happens is good life, Mr. Lee, good life can make your mind soft and your backbone weak and you lose any ability to fight and resist and to prevail. And then you and see what happens, you get too cute and you think, you know, and you get around these other people. And you forget who your God was who delivered your great-grandmother and your great-grandfather and your great-great-great-great-grandmother and grandfather out of slavery.
That's right.
Then you get around these people, get sophisticated, and forget who Jesus is. Mm. And then you get yourself in a mess. But let's talk. I got something I'm sort of excited about here. We got a District 7 race coming up here, right? And this is a fascinating race. And Mr. Lee, there's a young man, right, by the name of Jamal Crawford.
Oh,
man, he's just an exciting young man. I just think so much of him.
That's
right?
Another one of our stars, our fruit that was planted in some good soil and went through the trials and tribulations to understand the importance of being an upfront, stand-up man 24/7, not just when it's convenient.
I like him.
But
I like
him. Inconvenient. Yeah. This man, I mean, Jamal Crawford, I have to
He's
say,
a sharp young
sharp,
man.
Sharp young man.
You know.
And so he's running against District 7.
The Jackson 5. Anyone's going to Jackson 5?
Not the Jackson. It's the Tito. Not
ain't one of the Jacksons?
No.
Someone told me it's one of the Jacksons.
No.
You sure?
No, it's not one of the Jacksons. No.
Yeah, no, you sure not?
No.
No, I thought I saw Tito on TV with somebody
No. He
sort of look like the Tito boy. He smile like him, right? Let's smile a lot.
Yeah, he does smile.
So we're not talking about Tito Jackson from Los Angeles.
No.
Hollywood from Gary, Indiana.
No, we're talking Boston.
Okay, so there's a Boston Tito Jackson.
There's a Boston.
Is that right?
That's right.
There is a Boston Tito Jackson.
That's right.
Shut my mouth. Child, I didn't know.
Oh.
Okay, Tito Jackson from Boston.
Huh.
Well, I tell you what I do know. I know that Jamal Crawford, right, is a sharp, you know, young man who's a journalist. And I applaud him. Listen, I've never agreed with everything, right, the young man has said. Because I'm an old man, right, so I don't agree with everything. Right? But what I applaud all the time is, A, his integrity, his conviction,
that's right,
his intelligence,
that's right,
and his courage. You understand? He ain't got to be perfect, but if he's got integrity, intelligence, a fairly high level of sophistication, and frankly, this is what I love. He got heart.
No, he'll throw down.
Oh, no. He's going to mix it up. He ain't no chump.
No.
He don't spend all his life skinning and grinning and doo-wopping and dancing, shugging and jiving, slipping and sliding and, you know, doing the soft shoe around everything, right? Mm. The young man, and so you know, and this is a District 7 now, right?
District 7.
There's an exciting race, y'all, and I want you to look at this young man, Jamal Crawford.
Jamal.
He's the editor of a thing called the Blackstonian.
Information.
Okay.
Information.
Blackstonian. That's actually, you know, which and see, Blackstonian is important because we need some new journalism.
That's right.
We need some new voices and visions that's in right. the black community.
That's speaking the truth.
That speak the truth and ain't bought by nobody.
That's right.
Amen. Right. So if you're out there, I want you to check out my man Jamal Crawford,
District 7,
in District 7 race with a what's that boy name again? What's his name again? The other one?
Jackson.
Cupper. George Jackson.
No.
Leroy Jackson.
Tito Jackson.
The Tito.
He's our current city councilor.
Oh.
And
shut my mouth.
Jamal Crawford has identified that there's a lacking in representation in District 7.
Yeah.
And his own work over the years. No, I'm not talking about somebody who sat and looked through a window and said, oh, I need to jump in the race because I ain't got nothing better.
Yeah.
No, this is because what he has seen in his community are not happening. He said, I need to step up and be able to bring
a
new change.
Absolutely. No. Everybody, I want y'all to pay attention to Jamal Crawford. And that's going to be an exciting race, right?
Oh, it's going to be off the chain.
Yeah, no. We got a young black man. You know, we got Tito Jackson. God bless you. That's Tito, right? That's his name?
It's Tito. Yes,
sure
sir.
Now.
Yes, sir. Good brother. Good brother.
Yeah,
but you know, good brother, I just want to say something on the air since we're here. I don't want anyone to feel that we're talking about anybody in bad stead. Well, what I'm saying is that
we're trying to bring some humor to life.
I mean, which is good.
Yeah, you gotta have some humor. Lighten up.
We gotta understand. Some people aren't made to be a bus driver. Some people ain't made to be a police officer. Some people aren't made to be a fireman. Some people ain't made to be a city councilor.
Yeah.
Not saying they're a bad person.
Right.
It just ain't a good fit.
Right. No. That happens sometimes.
We're looking for fit.
Yeah, good fit.
We're
looking for people who just want skin and grin.
That's right.
When they go down there to see Mr. Charlie.
That's right.
You know, you got to go down there to see Mr. Charlie, and you got to conduct your business, and you got to do the right thing, and you got to be pleasant presentable and have the proper comportment, right? You got to have all of that, right? But then again, you just don't skin and grin. You got to go down there. You got to bring something back.
That's right.
You got to bring some resources back. Yeah, so we are excited. We are looking for some new life and vigor. I'm excited about the excellent work that Blackstonian does in attempting to elevate the black community. And frankly, let me tell you this. Did y'all know that last week in the New York Times, last Saturday, Jamal Crawford and those who've been really pushing on the issue of racial disparities in the black community in terms of what happens if it's the Boston Marathon with the white people and versus what happens to the black people. Jamal Crawford was in the New York Times.
That's right.
On the lead story on the national page of the New York Times, and they featured and gave a shout out to the Blackstonian. Very, very interesting article.
Very interesting.
And Mr. Crawford, you've listened, we want to give you props, player, for getting out there and standing up for the hood. Now, God bless you.
And we're not talking about just during political times. We know you've been out there a long time, good brother.
Yeah,
I just
want
to encourage folks, as you go out and vote and you're making decisions about, you want somebody who's going to fight for you, fight for the opportunity to have better schools, fight for safer streets, fight for economic development in your district. Jamal Crawford's the man.
Yeah, he do now. You're a young black man, very sharp, totally committed to the community, has given sacrificially. No. We give him props. Give him props, man, and pray God's blessings on Blackstonian, that it will grow as a new, fresh voice to give us a new vision of journalism with some excitement
originality.
Hi, this is Pastor Bruce Wall. You will not want to miss the Down Home Delivery Restaurant's Customer Appreciation Day. It's going to be Sunday, October 6, 2013, starting at 2 p.m. and going all the way to 5. Join us and meet our restaurant staff.
All right, so listen, Mr. Lee, it looks like we have come to the end of our hour here, trying to drop some knowledge. You know, I don't want to leave, but my wife is waiting at home for me, so I'm going to get on in. We want to thank Pastor Bruce Wall and Boston Praise Radio for giving us 60 minutes of knowledge as we talk about the issues that are affecting our community. You know, and so I'm thankful. I want to turn it over to Leonard Marion Lee.
I just want to really thank everybody. And I thank Reverend Rivers and Pastor Wall and Minister Hobbs. I mean, it's a blessing to be able to talk candidly about what's going on in our community and how we can empower ourselves to bring about real change. Remember, Tuesday is the day that we can bring about change and the promise that we can keep in our community. Do not be fooled by any type of news, commercial newspapers telling us what our destiny is. Let's talk about it. Let's walk about it. Let's get out of our homes and out of our beds and vote on Tuesday. And remember, Jamal Crawford, District 7, he is a write-in candidate. It may be a little challenging to make that happen, but remember, the road to goodness is not always easy. So therefore, we have to make that extra step to make sure that we can get the representation in District 7 that we need. Would you say, Reverend Rivers?
No, absolutely. Listen, we want everybody getting out to vote. We want you to write in Jamal Crawford. That, you know, he is our future. And we want to stand by this young man from our community. And again, we want to thank Boston Praise Radio for giving us this platform to drop some knowledge in the community.
That's right.